Thank you for the organization and first of all, and for the organization for this nice conference. And so let's start recalling some basic fact, which also somebody recalled, but I want to fix notation to go on, before to go on. And so let us fix M sigma, a Riemannian manifold. So in this talk, M is a smooth manifold and sigma is a Riemannian metric on it. So it is a well-known fact that if the manifold is connected, then in this talk all the manifold will be connected. The Riemannian structure define a metric structure in the sense that the manifold becomes a metric space. And to do this, you use as a distance function this one denoted by d sigma, which is the geodesic distance, which is defined in the following way. You fix two points, P and Q, on the manifold. You consider all piecewise smooth joining them. Then you take the infimum of all these lengths, of all the curves that you are considering. And this number is the geodesic distance between the points P and Q. So this is just to fix notation. Now, the question on which this talk is based on is the following one. Let us consider the case where the manifold is a Hilbert, a Banach, or a Fréchet manifold. So this means, roughly speaking, that charts have values no longer in Rn, but in one of these spaces. So, and now suppose we have defined what is a Riemannian metric in this setting. You can define what the geodesic distance following this definition, this not change. But the question is, what about the geodesic distance in this case? Is it still a distance or not? So, first of all, let us consider the case of Fréchet manifold, the most general one. Here, the answer is no. In general, you don't have a metric structure on so the geodesic distance is not a distance. And the problem is the following one. That is that the geodesic distance can be zero on distinct points. So it is a pseudo distance, but in general it does not separate points. And here I put some references where you can find examples of this phenomenon for Riemannian metrics on Fréchet manifolds. So in general, the geodesic distance is not a distance. But these are not all. These are not all the references. There are also other ones, essentially given by the same authors in this slide. And so the question is, why do we have all these examples in Fréchet manifolds of this phenomenon? And the answer is that these were given for specific Fréchet manifolds. Endowed with specific Riemannian metrics, which are interesting to study. And sorry, I don't want to enter into motivation for which they are interesting to study, but did Martin Bauer gave a talk about this and showed a nice one nice motivation to study this kind of situation. So let's go on and let us consider a more specific case. That is the one of Banach manifold. So the question is, what about the geodesic distance in this case? Is it a distance or no? So because up to now we have counterexamples in the Fréchet case. So is there a reason for which the Banach structure can prevent the vanishing of the distance? So this is the question which we will address in the rest of the talk, and on which my work in collaboration with Valentino Magnani is based on. So to address this question, let me introduce what are the Riemannian metrics that we are considering on Banach manifolds. So they are the so-called weak Riemannian metrics, which are defined in the following way. So at each point of your manifold, you assign an inner product on the tangent space at that point. So you have now a family of inner products, and you ask that this family depends smoothly on point of the manifold, And this can be done essentially as in the finite dimensional case using tensor bundles. This is not the problem. But what is the situation? Now you have a Banach manifold. So your tangent space is a Banach space. And we put an inner product on it. So now the inner product induces a topology, a topological structure of the tangent space. But since we are in a Banach manifold, the tangent space is also a Banach space. It has its own Banach structure. So the third request is about the relation between the two topologies, the Riemannian one and the Banach one. And what we ask is the following one. We ask to the Riemannian inner product to be continuous on the tangent space as a bilinear form, where on the tangent space you consider its own Banach structure. So what does it means? It means the following: that we are asking the fo to the following estimate between norms, two holes, where here on the left hand side we have the Riemannian norm and on the right hand side one Banach norm on the tangent space. So this is the definition of weak Riemannian metric. So, just to fix ideas, I want to show you an example, a little, at least to fix some idea of what can happen with Riemannian metrics. Okay, this is I wrote in roughly, but the point is that each chart induces a norm, a Banach norm. So I use this notation, but it depends on chart. It's the Riemannian one. The right hand side is one Banach norm, which is induced by charts. And as a manifold. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, also. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Also. Yeah, yeah. Yeah, yeah. Also this one. Okay. Thank you. And so another example can be the following one. For example, you can consider little L2 as a Banach manifold. It's a Hilbert space, but in particular it's a Banach manifold. And you can define a Riemannian, a weak Riemannian metric on it, such that if you fix one point, and what can happen is that the Riemannian norm of the standard orthonormal basis go to zero. This can happen because we are only asking for this inequality to hold. So we are not asking to the reverse one to hold. So the question is, why are we dealing with these strange examples? Can we ask something to prevent this? The point is that we cannot in general, because if we ask to the reverse inequality to hold, this means that we are asking to our Riemannian inner product to give the same topology, the Banach topology, which is too much to ask in general on Banach manifold. So this means, because this means that actually you are in a Hilbert manifold. So this means that if you want to study the Riemannian geometry of general Banach manifolds, you need to deal also with this kind of example. You cannot ask clearly too much on the topology which the Riemannian structure induces. And so this is why they are called weak Riemannian metrics. So now we have defined what are the Riemannian metrics that we consider. And let us go back to our original question. What about the geodesic distance in this case? So, is it a distance? That was the question. And the answer is no. And it was given in the following theorem by Professor Valentino Magnani in collaboration with myself, published in the 2020. And we have proved that there exists a weak Riemannian metric on little L2, such that the geodesic distance is completely zero, completely vanishing between any couple of points of the space. So this example is the first example in the Banach case. So So this is the first novelty. But I think the more interesting novelty of this example is its simplicity, because it's given in a like elementary situation. So in this sense, I think it's important because it shows that this phenomenon of the vanishing of the distance can really happen in a very simple situation. It's not something that you need to construct in some pathological way. So it's, I think this is the, yeah. I think that they are in Frechet case. Okay, because you need to see the you think to see the immersion in the Banach space. Yeah, I think. Yeah, but I think I mean in your case was a fresh. I mean, you need to check that maybe the technique works. You said you that works also in the Banach case. But is that? Okay. Okay. Okay, but can be also. Okay. Yes, that proof that you mentioned yesterday, is that proof in the, okay, but maybe we can talk later on about this. Okay, so I want to give at least the idea to let you see that this is an elementary situation. So let me sketch at least the idea of the proof, which is, it shows the simplicity of the example. So you fix two points, P and Q, on little L2, and you consider the following sequence of curves, gamma n, which joins the two points. And the curves are really simple to write because they are obtained gluing together these three-line segments. So, and here n is the standard vector, nth vector of the orthonormal basis of L2. And so what we proved is that there exists a weak Riemannian matrix sigma such that the length of this curve go to zero. So the geodesic distance between any two couple of points is zero by definition. So I don't want to write the exact formula for the Riemannian matrix, but it's once you have this curve in mind, it's not a complicated formula to write. Okay. So this sketch the proof. Now, it doesn't work. Okay. Now let us consider a more specific situation. That is the one of Banach Lie groups. So we have proved that in general on Banach manifold, the geodesic distance is not a distance. Let us consider a more specific case. Here, the weak Riemannian metrics that we consider are left invariant. So let me recall the definition. To define what is a weak Riemannian metric which is left invariant is essentially defined by giving an inner product on the tangent space at the unit element of the group, and then you move it using the left translation of the group to any other point. So this is a very strong assumption of the metric, because essentially everything depends on what you assign at one point, and then this determines using the group structure the inner product to any other point. So it's really strong. And so the question is, what about the geodesic distance? Is it now a distance or not? Because is there some reason for which the left invariance in the Banach case can prevent the vanishing of the distance? And the answer is no. And this was proved in the following theorem. By Magnani, Professor Magnani, in collaboration with myself in Revista Matematica Complutense. So we have proved that if you consider the infinite dimensional Heisenberg group, which is the space L2 times L2 times R, with a group operation, which is the standard, the analogous of the Heisenberg group operation in the finite dimensional case. So in this space, in this Hilbert group, you can find a weak Riemannian metric, which is left invariant, such that the following happens. So if you take points with the same projection on the first two components, the geodesic distance is zero. And if you consider points with distinct projection on the first two components, the geodesic distance remain positive. So in general it's not zero between any couple of points, but still it is not a distance because it fails to separate some points. So this is also, so I think one important message that we keep from this result is that again, also in the left invariant case, the geodesic distance can be vanishing, can be not a distance in really simple geometry, like the one of the Heisenberg group. So, and again, I want to sketch the proof, at least of the in the case of the vanishing of the distance, because to prove that here that I mean that in this case is positive is just it's very simple. So I want to sketch this this proof to show how to construct the curve. So, no, okay, that works. Okay, so let us do it at the origin. So you fix the origin and you fix a point, so in this vertical real axis, and you consider the following sequence of curves, which here I only draw here. So for HN is, you consider a curve alpha N, which, so I don't want to give you the exact expression of the curve, but it's not complicated, it's elementary. But then, so this is why I don't want to write it. But the important thing of which will be used in the rest of the talk is this one. That is that for HN, the nth curve is contained in the span of these three planes. So the green one, which is the plane spanned by the vector EN 0, 0 and 0, EN 0. The yellow one is spanned, contains this vertical real, real line and the vector EN 0, 0. And the red one contains the vector, this vector 0, EN 0 and the real axis. So what we have proved is that there exists a left invariant weak Riemannian metric on little L2 such that the length of these curves go to 0. So this means that the geodesic distance between these two fixed points is zero. Okay, so now let us consider, this question, which is the last part of the talk. So, is there a reason for which this curve alpha n are the ones whose length go to zero? That is there a relation with the metric itself? Which I think this is also a deeper question. And to try to answer, I think it's better to go back to Micor Mumford, that in the 2005 discovered the following phenomenon, that the vanishing of the geodesic distance occurs with a locally unboundedness of the sectional curvature. Which means the following, means that you fix one point, for every tangent space you have, for every plane in the tangent you have a sectional curvature, and when you look to the family of all these sectional curvatures, this is unbounded. So, and no, they suspected that there is a relation between the two parts. So, in our in the Heisenberg group, we proved the vanishing of the distance, and we also analyzed the sectional curvature to try to relate these two phenomena. So I said we tried to analyze the sectional curvature because computing sectional curvatures in infinite dimension is not for free. But when you fix towards the normal vector, what you need, I mean, if you have some condition, which here I call Darnold condition, you can compute the sectional curvature on the plane expanded by the two vectors. But when this condition is not satisfied, it's not clear up to now. I mean, Arnold showed that there, under some condition, you can do it. And indeed, in the Eisenberg group, we have found two vectors, which are the following one, for which Arnold condition is not satisfied. So, what about the curvature in this case? But, surprising fact, is that the Arnold condition is satisfied on these three sequences of planes. So we can compute, using Arnold's approach, the sectional curvature relative to these three sequences of planes. And what we have proved is that along the yellow and the red planes, so these are sequences of planes, along the yellow and the red one, the sectional curvatures go to plus infinity. And along the green one, they go to minus infinity. So these, it's important because these are the planes which contain the curve. So I think one important fact is that the sectional curvatures blows up exactly along a sequence of curves whose length are going to zero. But another thing which is important by this computation is that it confirms the intuition of Mikor and Mumford. That is, that should be a relation between the vanishing of the distance and the unboundedness of the sectional curvatures. And so this concludes the talk. Thank you for your attention.